Good morning, everyone. Good to see all of you. Glad that you were here on this Father's Day. We're excited this morning. Miss Suzanne is out of pocket today, and so she's traveling, so y'all pray for her as she travels. But in her stead, we have Miss BQ. She's going to play our prelude for us. Reminder, that was Faith of Our Fathers, by the way, so it is Father's Day, so happy Father's Day to all of you guys who are fathers. It's a blessing that you are here today to come and be part with us. What is going on in here? Why does it look like this?
VBS.
What?
VBS.
VBS. What does that stand for?
Vacation
Bible School. Yes, it is. That starts when? In the morning. We're going to start at 9 o'clock, so if you are teaching or leading somehow involved as an adult or whatever, what time do we need to be here, Miss VBS lady? 8:40 to 8:45 be here. We want to have a time to huddle up and pray, and so make sure that you're here a few minutes early so that we can do that as we are greeting our kids. Some of those kids will start coming in relatively early, so we want to be ready for them when they get here. So y'all make sure that you're here. We're going to have a grand time, and it's going to be an exciting time. Tasha, how many? We had 38 online signups, which means that we'll have some that come in that are not signed up online. So, I mean, we may be, 50-ish or so before all is said and done tomorrow, and then that number will fluctuate throughout the week. So we're just excited to be able to minister to one or 501, however many it is. So we're grateful for that. In light of the things that are going on, today being Father's Day, there will be no choir practice or evening worship tonight. So just keep that mindful, spend that time with your family. And then on Wednesday night, in light of Bible school, we will not have a Bible study or prayer time on Wednesday night. But we'll get back to our regularly scheduled programming next week. So that'll be ready to go for that. So, all right, let me just give you a couple of other announcements here. Some great things coming up. One thing that I'd really like for you to take note of is this Three Circles Evangelism Training. And let me get my glasses so that I can see this a little better. This is being held at Clearwater First Baptist Church. If you need directions to that, just let me know. I can help you. The address is there for you, 310 Church Street. It's a Beach Island address. It doesn't really feel like Beach Island to me, but that's what they say. But it's out Belvedere Clearwater Road to the left, and Clearwater First is on the right-hand side. So that is coming up Monday night, a week from tomorrow, June the 24th, at 6 p.m. at Clearwater First. So all you have to do is show up. The church has already registered. We registered as a whole, so we can take anywhere from one to however many we can take. So they have a big auditorium there. So if you're interested in this, this is a wonderful way to learn about this evangelism tool called Three Circles. And be here for that, or be there for that. That's going to be great. Our weekly Bible study for our ladies will not be this week. They have Ache and Praise. And I'll be honest with you, Miss Carolyn, I don't know where we'd put y'all this week anyway, because we got Bible school. So that, to work. Yeah, we put y'all to work. That's a great place for you. But that'll continue a week from Tuesday. We'll be back on track here, ladies, if you want to be part of that. A couple of things that are coming. We have a new sermon series. We're actually starting it today with Father's Day through the summer months. We're going to go through the parables of Jesus Christ, at least a few of them, to see how Jesus did the parables and stuff when he walked on the face of the earth here. And then we're also going to have some summer movie nights that are coming up. So different things right there that are happening. But right now, it is all about Father's Day and Vacation Bible School. So we're excited about all of this. Is there any further announcements that we need to remember? All right, well, let's welcome you. If you're visiting with us, there is a card that's in either end of the pew. If you'd like to fill that out, we'll receive an offering a little later today, and you can just drop that card in the plate as it comes by. And if you're visiting with us on Facebook Live, we're honored to have you today. So God bless you all as we worship the Lord together this morning. So let's pray together, and we will begin. Lord, what a day it is, once again, just to be able to come and honor you and be able to just talk with you and listen to you, and Father, just hear your word. And Lord, it's just a great way to start our week this week and every week, Lord, in the house of the Lord. So we're just grateful for that. We just ask that you take our worship today and just use it in a mighty way, Lord, as we strive to serve you in all that we do. Just show up today in a mighty way as the Holy Spirit. Just move in and out of us, Lord, as we seek your will, as we study your word together. Be with us as we sing today, and we give you praise, and we honor you for all things. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Stand with me, and let's sing about that. Let's sing about the house of the Lord today. There you go, just like that. Everybody sing this with me. We worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory. Aren't you glad he does? There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is truly in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. All right, let's sing together. We sing. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. Yes, he does. Because he hung up on that cross and he rose up from that grave. My God's still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is truly in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We were the beggars. Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners. And now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. We were the beggars, and now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, and now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord.
There's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. Oh, and there's joy in this house. Lord, we shout out your praise. Give the Lord a hand this morning. Amen.
Amen. Let's visit with one another, fellowship for just a few minutes, and let somebody know that you and Jesus love them. Amen. Song to sing this morning. It's good to be part of the family of God. So y'all sing this with me. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed, filled by His blood, joint heirs with Jesus. As we travel this sun, for I'm part of the family of God. Let's sing that again. There we go. And I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood, joint heirs with Jesus. As we travel this side, for I'm part of the family of God. Aren't you glad that we are this morning? Amen. Amen. You may be seated. We're excited. Again, we've been talking about Vacation Bible School a little bit already this morning. And Billy, we talked about it early. Were you able to get that video for me? Okay, awesome. All you got to do is say two words to Billy and he can fill in the rest of the sentence. He's a genius back there. And I'm so grateful for him and Tim and Tasha and our whole team that works back there. But we've been talking about, yes. You know, I'm going to say what I told to you earlier. If a church member that comes in for Sunday school and comes in for worship, if you actually knew what it took to put together an hour and 20-minute worship service with this technical stuff, it would blow your mind. So we're just grateful, so grateful for these guys who not only can do it, but they do it well, and they're passionate about it. You know, anytime that you can do a service and you don't have the entire congregation do a 180 turnaround to take a look at who's in the booth, that means that nothing went wrong. And it's a rare thing that we ever have anybody turn around and look. They're faceless people back there, but they do a wonderful, wonderful job. So now that I've buttered your bread with that, but it's good, seriously. We do want to show you the theme song video for Vacation Bible School this year. It's all about eating, and I'm good at that. So it's all about food truck parties. So here we go.
Hey guys, my name's Bree, and I'm your choreographer for this year's Food Truck Party VBS. Right now I'm about to show you the dance moves to our theme song, Food Truck Party. Please remember to mirror me. This means you're going to follow the moves as if you're looking right into a mirror.
Oh, y'all have to stand up and do this, by the way.
You raise your left hand.
Kidding.
If I raise my left foot, you raise your right foot. Awesome. Let's go ahead and get right into the video.
On the word of God.
When you see it rolling into your neighborhood, come taste and see that the Lord is good. This is a food truck party. This is a food truck party. This is a food truck party.
Kids are going to love that, and I'm excited about it. And I'm going to tell you, Lisa and I have been, this is our 19th Bible school together that she and I have done together, and with a lot of help along the way. And, of course, we did some before we were together as well. So we've done a lot of Bible schools, been around a lot of people who have helped us in so many different ways, including right here. I mean, this place was buzzing Friday with people just with glue guns and tape dispensers and ladders and whatever you can think of. They were out here really just getting everything ready. And the evidence is plain to see that they have really, really worked very, very hard to get us ready. And one of the things that I wanted to mention, we watched this video, and it just reminded me, and I didn't plan to say this, but I'm going to anyway, but we have a young lady who worked with us last year as our worship leader, and she did a phenomenal job. And I, over these 19 years, I don't think I've had anybody that I have worked with that was even close to what she did. And she is with us again this year, but Miss Alicia Abrahamson. She's excellent. Excellent. Excellent is not even a good enough word, but she does a wonderful job. And our kids are just so responsive to her, and she just really, really does great. So thank you to all of you who have been helping and all of you who are. But right now, God has given us some promises, hasn't he? So we can stand on those. Let's stand together, and let's standing on the promises together this morning. Let's sing.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises that cannot fall, listening every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior as my all in all. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God.
It's good to know that we have those promises, amen. We also have a friend, and his name is Jesus. So what a friend we have in Jesus. Let's sing this together. There we go. Sorry, Billy.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful who will all our sorrows share? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer.
Then we can also take the name of Jesus with us wherever we go. Amen. Let's sing that together. Take the name of Jesus with us.
Take the name of Jesus with you, child of sorrow and of woe. It will joy and comfort give you. Take it then where'er you go. Precious name, oh how sweet, hope of earth and joy of heaven. Precious name, oh how sweet, hope of earth and joy of heaven. Take the name of Jesus ever as a shield from every snare. If temptations round you gather, breathe that holy name in prayer. Precious name, oh how sweet, hope of earth and joy of heaven. Precious name, oh how sweet, hope of earth and joy of heaven. Oh, the precious name of Jesus, how it thrills our souls with joy. When His loving arms receive us, and His songs our tongues employ. Precious name, oh how sweet, hope of earth and joy of heaven. Precious name, oh how sweet, hope of earth and joy of heaven.
And all God's people said, amen. You may be seated. Brother Mike. Amen.
Thank you for the blessing that you've already bestowed upon us as we get here this morning. We've had good Sunday school classes, Lord. You've been kind to us. And today, Lord, we especially want to bring to you following week of Vacation Bible School. We know that a lot of work is already been in place. And we know that from previous years, Lord, we just want to have a good time this week. And we know that you're going to be with us. And we hope that there will be some child or something that will find you this week, Lord. Because, once again, everything that we do for your will and we do to bring souls to you. That's what we want to do. And we ask that you do it. We ask that you bless all of our other ministers here in this church. And Lord, we especially ask your blessings on this, Lord. This week, we had a lesson here at the church that just shows that we live in troubled times, Lord. We live in times where there's people that are homeless and the people that are in need. And we at a church body, so often we fail to forget them. We also know that we have here those caring and loving people that take care of situations like that. And we are so thankful for those people. We ask you to bless all of ours. Sit those people in our church that might have concerns over the sickness. And we also ask, Lord, that you be with those families that both are sick. Lord, we know that the caregivers can be just as troubled as the person that's sick.
And just so you know, that was Miss Suzanne. She came up, Billy, 3 or 4 weeks ago now, I guess, and they got together and they recorded the music that you're hearing this morning is all recordings of her in anticipation of her being out today. So we're just grateful that they took the time to do that so that we would not have silence. We have some music that's going on, so it's wonderful. Well, today is Father's Day, and we're excited about that, and we want to recognize all of our dads today, our fathers, if you would just stand and so that we can acknowledge you today. Yeah. Amen. Thank you. And if you did not get a donut, I think there's donuts left. And there's a little gift for you as you leave. There's another dad sneaking his head in the door back there. Hello, Dad. There he is. Amen. But it's good to have you guys here. We do want to honor you today, and it's a heavy responsibility to be a dad and to be a father, and we're just grateful for you guys and what you do in trying to raise your children in the ways of Jesus. So just grateful for that. Adrian has put together for us a little short video, and Billy, if we have that, let's go ahead with that.
The world can be so noisy and confusing. It's easy for a child to feel so small. that faith in God will be my guiding star. I've seen you turn to Him for strength and solace, and I know who I am because of who you are.
Someone who lights the way with every step I take.
Amen. Thank you all so much. Thank you, Adrian. Beautiful presentation. Thank you, Billy, Tasha, you guys for getting that input this morning. Wonderful, wonderful. Did y'all happen to notice the picture of Billy and BQ with Tucker? Did you see? Did you see Tucker? I got a story about Tucker. Y'all mind if I tell my story about Tucker? We were over there one evening and we had had dinner and I think we had sat down to watch a movie or something. And Tucker is the king of this household, just in case you don't know that. And Tucker has several siblings in his house, but Tucker is Tucker, and he's the man. And sitting there watching the movie, I forget now what it was, and all of a sudden, out of nowhere, from my left to right, comes Tucker on the back of the couch. The snout goes in this ear. The tongue comes out of this ear. So if you ever want a good wet willy, go to the garments. You can get one of those. Stand with me as let's sing this morning. Lord, reign in me. Let's sing together.
my darkest hour. You are the Lord, though I am. So won't you reign in me again? So won't you reign in me again?
Give the Lord a hand this morning. He reigns in our lives. May be seated. God bless you. Well, good to see all of y'all. Turn with me over to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 15. And we are going to begin reading here in just a few minutes with verse 11. I believe the children are headed back with Miss Diane. God bless you guys. Well, it is Father's Day. And I'm excited about that. This day is on the calendar every year, just like Mother's Day and Christmas and all these. But this is the time that we celebrate our fathers. And I guess we can call this a holiday. Do y'all consider this a holiday? Yeah, kind of. Yeah, there you go. I got some ammunition yesterday from one of our kids, so that's holiday. Got a little 9mm and some 12-gauge and a big thing of Toblerone chocolate, which is exactly what I needed with those two donuts that I ate this morning. But excited about that. We'll get that. But I guess we could call it a holiday. And it's not like Christmas or Easter to me, though. It's not that kind of holiday, probably not even a birthday. It's not one of those holidays that I just look forward to it getting here, if you catch my drift. You understand what I'm saying with that. But it's Father's Day. And I've had a few godly examples of godly fathers in my life all the way throughout my years. And of course, my own biological father, my father-in-law, and some other men along the way have shown me what I believe is the correct biblical example of what a father ought to be. And there's a big difference and a big turn in what a biblical father looks like as opposed to what a worldly father looks like. And we're going to take a look at that a little bit today. So I guess this is kind of where I get this from. Now, none of these guys that I'm talking about, my dad or these other men that I'm talking about, they never expected any pats on the back. They never expected any attaboys. They didn't look for praise or anything like that in order to tell them how good of a father they were. They weren't looking for that. They just weren't looking for accolades for something that they had ought to have been doing anyway. Does that make sense? That's the reason that they did that. So as men of God, listen, we are commanded to be good fathers, aren't we? However that shakes out, biblical fathers. And the scriptures lay this out for us in detail on how a godly father should be and what this should look like. Now, I can't say that I don't enjoy all of those cards, those gifts, and those attentions that I get as being a father. I've enjoyed it, and I appreciate it very, very much, but I don't feel as if I deserve any type of accolades for being what God has called me to be. There's been times along the way that as a father, I have not always gotten it right. Some of y'all may be able to say that as well. There were times when I missed the mark, and at times I didn't set the right example. There were times that I just didn't say the right things. A lot of times, things came out of my mouth with a knee-jerk reaction, or maybe even possibly out of frustration with something that was not what God would have wanted me to say in that particular instance. I'm a human being. But at the end of the day, my children know that I love them. And they know that I want to be the dad that God intended me to be. They know that I want what is best for them. And they know that I have tried my best to set the best example that I could possibly set for them. And they know that I am first in line to help them with anything that I could possibly help them with that is within my power. They know this. So I'm proud of all of them. The man, Jared, and then the three girls, and you know, the women that they have become. I'm honored that God chose me to be head of that family. But over the summer months, and we mentioned this a little bit earlier, we're going to be taking a look at some of the parables of Jesus Christ. I was doing some research on how to handle summers in the church, and you could tell today that our attendance is not what it always is, and it hasn't been for the last 3 or 4 weeks, and I think that's due to the summer stuff coming in. So the things that I have read said that you don't want to get into a big theological type series during the summer, that you want to be planning for the winter. So that's what we're going to be doing, and we're going to be looking at the parables of Christ over the summer. Not that they're not deep enough, because they are. There's a lot of rich theology there, but it's not like a set series that we're going to be talking about over the next several weeks. But we're going to start today with a very familiar parable. So again, Luke chapter 15, and we're going to look at this passage from verses 11 through 32, and you're going to recognize this as the parable of the lost son. Y'all have seen this parable before. We've talked about it many times with many different Bible studies, but as we unpack this today, we're going to discover something. We're going to discover, yes, it is about this lost son, but it's also about this gracious father. That's who this parable is about. So let's stand together and let's read this. Again, this is Jesus speaking. We'll start again in verse chapter 15, verses 11 through 32, I think that it is. Sorry, I'll get to the right page here in a minute. If you got it, say I got it. All right, it reads this way. Jesus continued. Again, everything that I have in my scripture right here is in red. This is Jesus talking. Well, it's got blue over it, so I know where it is. But it's red. You'll see that. Jesus continued, there was a man who had how many sons? He had two. The younger one said to his father, Father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and he hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare, and here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants." So he got up and went to his father. But he was still a long way off, or while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." But the father said to his servants, "Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let us feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found," so they began to celebrate. Well, meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. "Your brother has come," he replied, "and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound." The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, "Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and have never disobeyed your orders, yet you never gave me even a young goat so that I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours who has squandered your property with prostitutes comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him." "My son," the father said, "you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad, because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." Let's pray together. Lord, thank you for this parable, for this wonderful passage of Scripture that we have here from our doctor, Luke. Lord, we just pray that you bless us this morning as we dig into this a little deeper. And just pray, Father, that we see the example that this father gave as we celebrate Father's Day together today. So we thank you, Lord. We love you. Just bless us in every word. Just let it be your word that comes. We just pray, Father, that you honor it in every way. In Jesus we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you. Now, I've heard this story called the parable of the prodigal son. Of course, what does the word prodigal mean? The prodigal word means wasteful. If you were to look that up, that's what it means. It means to be wasteful or to throw things away. Of course, reading it closer, again, it could be called not only the parable of the lost son, but it could also be called the parable of a loving father, which is where we're going to put most of our focus today. But this parable puts a great emphasis on the graciousness. Everybody say graciousness. The graciousness of the father even more so than the sinfulness of the son. When you really look into this. Now notice in this parable that it wasn't the father going out to look for his son. Rather, it was the son having flashbacks remembering the goodness of his father. What a vision that gives us. So this is what brought this son back to repentance and then ultimately forgiveness from the father. So through this very descriptive parable, we see three different experiences that this younger son went through on this journey through this portion of his life. We're going to look at these. First, we see something. We can see his rebellion. Everybody say rebellion. That's what we see. We must remember that this is the younger son. So let me set this stage for you. Back in those days, the older or the firstborn son had rights. He had birth rights. They were certain rights that went with being the firstborn. So we can look at this, and I have it on the screen. I want to show you some of where this came from, way back in the Old Testament in the book of Deuteronomy. You can find it there. You can write this on your note sheet, and here's the scripture right here. Deuteronomy chapter 21, verses 15 to 17 reads this way. If a man has two wives and loves one but not the other, and both bear him sons, but the firstborn is the son of the wife he does not love, when he wills his property to his sons, he must not give the rights of the firstborn son of the wife he loves in preference to his actual firstborn, the son of the wife he does not love. Now that's a lot to say right there, isn't it? But he must acknowledge the son of his unloved wife as the firstborn by giving him what? A double share of all that he has. This son is the first sign of his father's strength. The right of the firstborn belongs to him. So you can see that there is a lot of concern about who gets what and how this is divvied up, is how I would say that in today's terms, is how this was all given and how it was all separated away. But it was legal, though, for the father to distribute his wealth while he was still alive. This was legal if he desired to. So this younger son was actually within his rights to ask for his share of the estate, and he could even sell it if he wanted to. This is how this worked. He was within his rights, but it sure wasn't a very respectful or a loving thing for him to do. He might as well have told his father something of this nature. You're dead to me. You ever heard somebody say something like that? You're dead to me. I don't want anything else to do with you. Just give me what rightly belongs to me. I'm moving on. See you later. That's pretty much what he said. You're dead to me. This could not have been any more rebellious, which is our first point, rebellious on his part. He wanted to venture out on his own, and he wanted to spread his wings, so to speak. You ever heard these kids these days? I just need to go spread my wings. You ever heard that? I have. But I've seen kids this way. But here's the old saying. Maybe you'll remember this. You've heard this as well. You don't know what you've got till it's gone. You ever heard that? Well, this is a rebellious young man, and he was about to find out about all of that. So he was being covetous. Everybody say covetous. He wanted what other people had. He was putting greater value on things than he was people. He was more interested in pleasure than he was the duty that he had with his family. Now, Jesus had even warned the two brothers earlier in the book of Luke with the parable of the rich fool, which is one that we may get to over the summer. Luke 12, 15 says, then he said to them, watch out, be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions. This warning was on point because the man who has covetous in his heart can never be satisfied. You know people that way? Sure we do. They always want more. And then when they get more, they want more of that. And then they want more of that. It's a never-ending cycle. They have that causes a dissatisfied heart. That's what that is. It's a dissatisfied heart, and it's going to lead, a dissatisfying heart will lead to a disappointing life because you can never, ever have enough. He wanted to go to this far country is what the Scripture told us. Now, this doesn't mean that it's an actual destination. It's not like for us getting in the car, going to a far country over to Atlanta. That's our destination. That's where we're headed. This was not like that. It was just a far, it was anywhere but here. A far country. The far country exists where? It exists in our hearts. Sometimes we just need to rebel and just get away from it all. You ever feel that way? For this young man, he dreamed of enjoying being completely out of the shadow of his father. He wanted to do whatever he wanted to do, whenever he wanted to do it. He was like a sheep. He was lost when he gets out of the vision of the shepherd. And he wanted to have his own way, so what did he do? He rebelled, and as he was rebelling, he was breaking the very heart of his own father. So this passage goes on to tell us that this far country wasn't what he thought that it might be. He spent all of his inheritance. Every bit was gone. He spent it all. His so-called friends, while he had all of the stuff that he had, they left behind. He became a victim. He became a victim of famine. He was forced to do something for a stranger that he refused to do for his own father. What did he have to do? He had to go to work. He didn't want to do that. But that's what he ended up doing. Now you see, this is a constant reminder to us of what sin does to our lives if we reject the will of the Father. You see, sin promises freedom, but instead it brings slavery. That's what it does. John 8:34 tells you this. Jesus replied, "Very truly I tell you, everyone who sins is a slave to sin." Sin promises success, but it brings failure. It promises life. But what does the Bible tell us? The wages of sin is what? Death. So this young man thought in his rebellious way that he was leaving his father and all that he knew to go find himself. Instead, he found out just how lost he really was. He came to his senses, though, and I like the way God's Word puts that. It says that. He came to his senses. All of a sudden, the light clicked on. He had an epiphany. All of a sudden, it all started making sense. Something about being broke that makes that happen. Something about being hungry that makes that happen. You come to your senses. In verses 17 to 19, then he realized that he had a need for something else. He had a need for repentance. Now, what does it mean to repent? To repent means, listen, to repent means to change your mind. That's what it means. And that's what happened to this young man as he was slopping these hogs, these pigs. He was feeding them. Now, what a job for a Jewish boy. We'll get into that some other time. But through his mistakes, through his famine, through this menial job, he changed his mind about himself and his situation. He admitted to himself that he was a sinner. He came to realize that his father was actually a good man. He was a generous man, and that working at home with his father was far better than what he thought was going to be freedom in a faraway land or a faraway country. Remember what he said. He said, "Maybe my father will accept me back as a servant." Did you catch that? Just as a servant, I'm no longer worthy of being called his son anymore. I'm no good to him that way. His circumstances caused him to see his father in a new light. He was willing to come back to his father in any situation that he could get back to him in. Didn't matter what it was. He wasn't only experiencing regret. He wasn't only experiencing remorse. He was truly experiencing repentance here. He was willing to act on his repentance. He wanted to swallow his pride and go back home to whatever capacity that his father would accept him in. Now, verses 20 to 24 give us a picture of this reunion of rejoicing. Picture this and try to put yourself right there in the sand where this happened. This young man's father saw him coming from a distance. It's important to notice what transpired here. The father, listen, he didn't wait for the son to arrive, did he? He didn't wait on him. He ran to him. This father could not wait to get to this prodigal son. Could not wait to get to him. This young man started to confess, but his father wouldn't even let him finish. He interrupted him and said, "Hey, quick, go get the best we have. Look who's here. Go get the best robe. Get him a ring. Get him a pair of sandals." Why? Because we're getting ready to have a party. That's what this father was saying. He interrupted him. He forgave him. He ordered this celebration to begin. Now think of this. Everything that this young son had hoped to find somewhere else, he found it right there at home. Right there. He had clothes. He had jewelry. He had all the friends he could stand. He had love. He had assurance. He learned to appreciate what he had. Now, the father didn't ask him to earn his forgiveness. He just freely gave him his forgiveness. The best robe and the ring are more proof of the forgiveness of the father. The robe likely actually belonged to the father. The ring was a sign of what we call sonship. Servants, well, they didn't wear expensive clothes. Servants didn't wear rings or shoes or jewelry. This celebration of eating the best calf was the father's way of showing forgiveness and joy. And he wanted everyone to know that his son was home and that his son was well. Well, all was well except for one other person. Jesus continued with this parable in verses 25 to 32. And the father's older son was out working in the field when the younger brother arrived at home, and he was completely unaware that the younger brother had arrived back there until he got close enough to hear the music and hear and see the dancing. So a servant explained to him what was going on. This older brother had some virtues that were commendable. He worked hard. He obeyed his father. He never disgraced his family. But he must have had plenty of friends, according to verse 29. It seemed like a model citizen compared to his younger brother. He was in no way, shape, or form about to accept his younger brother back without being heard. He had something to say. So after he refused to come inside to the party, the father came to him and he pleaded for him to come in. What did he do? He decided to stay out and pout. That's what this older brother did. He missed out on the joy of forgiving his own brother, and in the process, ended up breaking his father's heart again. He chose to totally stay out of fellowship with his family. Now, all we really know is how the parable ended here. It ended with the father saying, "My son who was dead is now alive. He was lost, but now he is found." We see that. But with forgiveness comes joy. As we think of fathers today, I have an acronym that I think would help you with your walk as a Christian father. And let me just give you these. I didn't put them on the screen, but you can write these down. Father begins with an F. A father should always be forgiving. The second letter in the word father is A. A father helps protect his family with the armor of God that we've been talking about for the last 8 or 10 weeks. The T means that a father should be a teacher and an example to his children and his wife. The H means that he should be a helper in the time of need. The E means that the memory of a father is everlasting. And the R should be that a father should be looked up to and respected. Biblical father, that is. I can tell you, and I've given you testimony many times about my own father, and you know, I think of him a lot, and it's not every day now. He's been gone for 21 years, been with Jesus for that long. It's hard to believe that he has been gone for that long, but my dad imitated Christ in my lifetime as much as anybody that I had seen. Now, my dad had not always been a Christian. He didn't grow up that way. But when he became a Christian, he understood what it meant to follow Christ, and he did his best to do that. And he left an example for me that is just implanted into my brain. I can't help but see his example when things come up in my life. You know, how did my dad handle that? You know, that happens to me from time to time. And my hope is that my children can say the same thing about me. You see, I saw the Holy Spirit working through my dad. He certainly had a forgiving heart. He had to. I was his kid. So I'm thankful for his forgiving heart. My memories of him are exceptional. They really are. And he was not only my dad, he was my friend. Miss him dearly. He taught me about Jesus. He and my mother both. He made sure that I was in a Bible-believing church that could answer spiritual questions for me that he didn't know the answer to. He made sure. He was there to celebrate with me when I accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior as a 7-year-old child in 1974. I'll never forget. He was at every chorus concert. He was at every band competition. I ran the man ragged. Everywhere. He believed in me when I didn't believe in myself. He was truly an example of a godly father. Now, you know, I say these things about him, and I realize that not everybody has it like that. I understand that. I know that there are folks that live in today's world that did not have this example. Our world has changed so much. The absence of a father in the household is what now is called normal. Broken home numbers are on the rise. Fathers have become donors instead of being daddies. There's only one way to change that trend. Jesus. He's the only one that can change it. Only Jesus can change the heart of these kinds of dads to get involved with their children and their families and make them stand up and shout what Joshua did, "As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." Only Jesus can make these changes. So this morning, church, we're going to pray. I don't necessarily want to close this service by singing a verse or having a recording play a verse and just having a dismissal prayer. I think it's important that we take the time to pray for our dads. And for those of us who are dads, it's time for us to pray for our children. We need to take the time to do that. We need to pray for family restoration. I want to pray that God will instill in our fathers today the heart of this father to the prodigal son. So this altar today is open as it always is. We didn't even decorate down there so you could have some room. And I know some of you today, actually, as we've been talking about this, this has reminded you of a particular father. It might not be your father. But a particular father in today's world that's in your mind right now that needs somebody to pray for them. I know there's families that's right now in need of prayer. Maybe you're here today, you don't know Jesus as your Savior. I can help you with that today. I would love to tell you everything I know about what it means to be a Christian and how to become a child of the anointed King. I would love to tell you that. Maybe you've been visiting with us for a while. You'd like to join fellowship with our church. We would love to have you. You can come and make that known. But all you need to do is come this morning. That's what you need to do. You just need to come and pray for someone in your life that's missing the boat where Jesus is concerned. Maybe it's a father. That's who we've been talking about today. Maybe it's even a mother. Maybe it's a sister. Maybe it's someone in your life that you know that needs prayer. Today is the day to pray for them so that they can get right with Jesus. Would you do that? Again, our altar's open. Stand right where you are. And you come this morning as God leads you. Billy's going to start our song, but you come. You come this morning. Good to know that we have the amazing grace of Jesus. Amen. Certainly it is. Well, don't forget, there will be no evening worship or no choir practice this evening. It's Father's Day. Enjoy this time together with your family. And in the morning, bright and early, we're starting with Vacation Bible School. So we're excited about that. It's going to be a great, great week. So again, if you're involved in that, we would love to have you here, say 8:40-ish, somewhere right there. And I believe we still have room for some volunteers. If anybody else would like to show up, we will put you to work. We have plenty of places to do that. So you come and be part of what's happening here at God's Church here at Cornerstone. So thank you so much. Going to ask our deacon, if he would, to Brother Mike, I believe, to have our benediction. We'd like to thank you for joining us on Facebook Live this morning. I truly hope that you've been blessed by something that's been said this morning. We just want to glorify the Lord here at Cornerstone. I pray that you've made a decision for Jesus Christ today. If you don't know Him, I pray that you have come to know Him this morning as your personal Savior. If you have, drop us a line. You can go to cbcaiken.com/contact. And you can leave me a message there. You can send me an email. It'll come directly to me. And that will let me know exactly what your decision for the Lord was. If you just need a prayer request, anything like that that you may need, that's a great place for you to go to do that. So join us again. We'll be live again on Facebook Live next Sunday morning at 10:45. And then also on Wednesday nights, we're live at 6:30 for a Bible study. So join us. We'd love to see you there. Have a great, great day.